This is for the OTR Foundation in Pueblo House. Our first house was donated in March 2012 after visiting Fifth Street and writing to four property owners about donating their boarded-up dilapidated house to a good cause. They did. We spent 19 months renovating the house with the help of many volunteers and businesses. We weren't sure what house was going to be. While working on the first house, I was still doing a career with traveling, went back and forth from Chicago to New York, listened to the people who were dealing with the results of the financial meltdown, and when I returned, it was in November 2013, to stay and bring something to the community. We went to work, cleaning, fixing, rebuilding, decorating our new community house, which had now become a place for youth to find their passion, make art, play music, and make electronics. Gee, I thought it was running out of time. You're okay, so. By the way, the kids singing are from Pueblo House. They're singing Over the Rainbow. Our second house, two doors east, was donated in May 2013, and by sheer luck, the owner was found and convinced to let us make it into a music space for the community. Once again, we were knee-deep in renovations, permits, and decorating on the cheap with a very limited budget. This beautiful little stone house now looks like that. Our yard is a big open area consisting mostly of sand and weeds. Thanks to Lowe's, Pioneer Sand, and many other businesses and volunteers, we now have a horseshoe pit, fire pit, stage, sprinklers, grass, and a barbecue area. The third house, two doors west, is located on the other side of NeighborWorks Garden, which is perfect. The house was donated in 2015, and given the bad shape of this house, we waited to see if it would be feasible to fix and at what cost. We've decided to do the repairs and make this house a media center with recording studio and plenty of computers for digital teaching and building programs. We're still waiting for a permit on this house. We face many issues since it was scheduled to be demolished. This house, like the other two, is historic status. The city has given some unrealistic demands, so Stan is just replacing windows, doors, and fixing drywall in the meantime until we get our permit issued.
Our low-power radio station was launched March of 2017. We've interviewed many local musicians and had their music on the air. We air roundtable discussions, community issues, and events happening all over Pueblo. Some of the music clips in this presentation are by local musicians Beyond Bridges, Devin Sandstephen, and Terry Dead.
So we're going to start our own currency, a barter system that we think will be helpful to the east side to be able to trade services. And then we have our three dogs as well, Sadie, Kayla, and Bailey. We rescued the two greyhounds, two out of six that survived. And Kayla was one that I brought into the RV early on when we first started. In 2014, one teen mom and three of us wrote a book that describes what we do here. We have written in both Spanish and English to acknowledge our Latino population. The book contains actual children from the East Side. The movement book was written by me after spending time in the U.S. and how I ended up in Pueblo. Thanks to Lowe's, we have a yard with a full stage, and thanks to NeighborWorks, we have a music shed. When you don't have a lot of money, it helps to be creative and use things that wouldn't normally be used, like meat trays for ceilings and egg cartons to cover old beat-up cracked walls. Paint is our best friend, and we thank Southern Colorado Services and Recycling for all the paint they donated. We love to watch youth learn new things, and we encourage good health, so when we get a chance to read labels, make our own food and sell products, which all the proceeds go back to the Pueblo House, we're teaching young people about being entrepreneurs and how money works for good things. We're proud of our new yard. We have plenty of room for gardens, and we've been fortunate for the many crops yielded. Our three fruit trees planted this year already have peaches growing on them, but we could use some volunteers to help plant our gardens. We're still not planting yet, so we have a little bit going on over at Pueblo House. Those that have been there understand that phrase. With Maya's guidance and expertise, we had a clay oven built and we all learned how to stomp clay. Our events, like the open mic gym, might see plenty of talent coming this way, like Beyond Bridges and Carrie Dell Trio. Most times we record and put those up on the radio. This is actually Carrie Dell singing. We were fortunate to have so many people and businesses help us. Our thanks go to all those who shared our vision for youth needing more, especially on the east side, and a place where community could come together. As you can see, we had a lot of help. We take every opportunity to educate, and these are a few of the things we've done. We're all about giving power to the kids and letting them do what's comfortable, no matter their age. We have shown great strengths in certain areas. A lot of kids are doing more than their parents thought they could because we give them full rein and very limited restriction. We're going to do more of this going forward. These are events we've done to keep busy in the community. We do our best to work with others on projects, and we enjoy a lot less structure for our youth because we want them to do what makes them happy, and I think engaging the youth in what they think is needed is the best way. We're starting a new program. On June 23rd is our open house, and we're going to have an Adopt-a-Grandma program for young families that have kids that maybe don't have any parental help or advice. So these are our three houses, the before and after, except for that one, that's still a monstrosity. But the good news is we have 23 volunteers coming from the church, and that house will be painted. So we're pretty excited about that. Finally, I'd like to recognize the man, Stan Clark. If he's here, if he'd stand up. Stan is back there.
Why don't you come over to the east side of town? Why don't you come visit the east side of town?
Thank you, everyone.
Hi, my name is Dina Higgins. I'm a fourth generation rancher. My family has been active in farming and ranching for over 90 years. Today we run cattle on a small ranch in Walsenburg. So my interest in animals came at a very young age. The way my grandfather and uncle handled horses greatly influenced this young girl. My grandfather used his horses on the ranch while my uncle showed and bred horses for Hank Lee's camp. I guess it's in our blood. So it is my passion we are going to talk about today. That is horses and their contributions in the past, present, and future. The horses that came here with the Spaniards were a hardy breed. We can trace many of the horse breeds of today back to the Spanish farm, such as the Appaloosa Quarter Horse, Palomino Paint, Buckskin, and many other color breeds. Some of these horses became feral. Feral means they were tame and turned wild when they either escaped or had to fend for themselves. Indians captured these horses, and some tribes became very proficient in their horsemanship skills. Indians could ride bareback at high speeds while hanging off the horse's side. The horse began to change this country's future very early. The horse made it easier for Indians to move their camps to follow and hunt the buffalo. Between rival tribes, they became a symbol of power and strength. When the explorers and trappers came to this land, they brought more horses, this time from England. New colonies were built. Further exploration by trappers and explorers became possible because of the horse. These horses helped settle the West by pulling the settlers' wagons, hauling logs for homes and forts, buying fields for harvest and trade, as well as carrying messages and mail by means of the Pony Express. The horse soldiers, later known as the cavalry, came to protect settlers. Cowboys moved and tended stock to build cattle ranches for beef. They usually picked and broke horses they thought would be swift or dependable in everyday tasks. Many celebrations involved saddle bronc riding, draft pulling contests, and horse racing. The horse became a symbol of wealth. Horses were bred to improve qualities that were needed in daily transportation by ranchers and farmers. The horse industry continued until the horseless carriage. Jobs horses did were being taken over by industry. The last horse-drawn fire engine was retired on December 22, 1922, when the New York City Fire Commissioner Thomas J. Drennan and other dignitaries gathered in back of Borough Hill to pay their final tribute to the five fire horses by placing wreaths around their necks. Belle Griffin, Fanny Begg, Waterboy, Penrose, and Bucknell. As industry grew, horses had to take on a new role. There were a few ranchers along with the Native Americans that maintained the horse was still useful. Horse breeders such as Hank Wieskamp raised confirmation and performance horses. Many of the Skipper W and Plodet lines can be traced back to Hank's breeding program. Today, horses are still used on ranches for cattle. In West Cliff, the horse is being used to pull carriages for transportation, plowing and clearing logs. Harry Bold's rodeo horses show off their athleticism during the bareback and saddle bronc riding at the rodeos. These horses know their job. Once they are put in the chute, just like any athlete, they're ready for the gate to open to try to get the rider off. Secretary, also known as Big Red, and his owner, Penny Chenery, helped to make horse racing popular too. Red's time of 22.4 seconds and 31 lengths still stand today. Monty Roberts became one of the first true horse whisperers. He was a pioneer in new training methods. At a young age, he listened and watched horses in the wild and learned their language. Ranchers such as the Cole Ranch are giving clinics to educate the public in their way of life. Ranchers help new riders experience what the true purpose of the horse was and is by putting the natural working ability of the horse back where it belongs. That is on the daily tasks of ranch sorting, penning, branding, and doctoring. Again, in the spirit of the Old West, the competitions help keep it profitable. Cowboys can have bragging rights and serenade how good their horses are. Hope Through Hooves is an organization where the horse is taken on the role of therapists for families in crisis or grieving. Horses, Heroes, and Hope help soldiers with PTSD or rehab those with injuries. As an instructor, a trainer, and a 4-H leader, I've seen 4-H members learn patience, understanding, responsibility, teamwork, and commitment. I've seen them grow and become productive citizens under the watchful and caring eye of a horse. They call their partner and friend. The horse is non-judgmental. They are kind and gentle or firm and stubborn when needed. There is a saying about teamwork. You don't know teamwork until your partner is a 1,200-pound free spirit. As to the future of the horse, well, I think the horse will be here for a long time. If the rancher, Native Americans, weekend cowboys and girls, backcountry horsemen and hunters have anything to do with it. Ranchers and the Native Americans have been stewards of the horse. There is a saying, take only what you need and leave the land and horse as you found it. Horses give kids a sense of purpose and its skills. They teach problem solving, coping skills, organization, and a peace of mind. The horses will always be a big advocate of peace and serenity. If you want to learn more about some of these amazing people and their horses that influenced my love of horses, read the Hank Wieskamp story by Frank Holmes, The Appaloosa by Bill and Donna Richards, The Man Who Listens to Horses by Monty Roberts, The Duke of the Chutes, Harry Holt's story, Years in Rodeo by Lauren Whitmore, and The Last Cowboy by Davis L. Ford. Or watch the video on Secretariat. I'm going to leave you with this thought. One can get on in a car and see what man has made, but one must get on a horse to see what God has made. Author unknown. Thank you.
The power of art is immeasurable, but it can be seen, heard, felt, and experienced. Art can affect us in ways that can be understood and misunderstood simultaneously. Art can be constructive and destructive at the same time. Art can deliver hope and inspire change. Art can change a person, a community, and the entire world in a single vocation. Like alchemists turning lead into gold, artists take one thing and turn it into another. Artists change ideas into tangible things. They can turn thoughts into the world that we see, and they can turn feelings into the knowledge that we share. Artists share, artists bring into reality things which did not exist before, and they give life to things which before stood only lifeless. An idea enters the artist's head, and the creative process begins. They doodle, draw, sculpt, play, and battle frustration as step by step these ideas become realized. All things made by man come to be this way. Some things manifest with ease, and others with great difficulty. Some with absolute intent, and others by complete accident. The artwork that I have created over the past 5 years within Pueblo has been to make the invisible visible. I see blank walls and visions and come to me what could potentially be. I see walls in states of decay, and beneath the surface I catch glimpses of the murals that could exist if a bit of paint was simply applied to reveal them. Through painting murals and public works of art, entire communities can be transformed. By simply adding color in interesting ways to the walls that already exist, the feel of entire communities and whole cities can be changed quickly and inexpensively. By changing the visual landscape with color, the complete feeling of the community can be changed and the culture enhanced. Large-scale works of art begin to stand as cultural icons and as monuments by which the community defines itself. In 2016, I painted the side of the San Cristo Arts Center to add a splash of color to our downtown and to enhance this already iconic building. The painting took 16 days and is visible from the field. Through my lifelong journey as an artist, the most powerful thing I have discovered is the ability art has to turn negatives into positives. Artists can take that which has been broken and neglected and make it fresh again. Art has the ability to cross boundaries and remove fears. Through art, we can reveal the truths of the unknown and ease the anxiety of not seeing the beauty hidden just beyond the shadows. With a creative perspective, we can begin to examine our negative thoughts, our darkest feelings, and traumatizing experiences, and we can begin to express them. We can express them in ways that fit our own comfort levels, yet still have the effect of letting go of the things we have buried. This painting deals with my fears of death and rejection. Meet Your Monsters is a coloring book self-assessment. The goal of the book was to share my knowledge of art's ability to turn negatives into positives. The book has 60 pages, consisting of 30 pages of questions where the reader is asked to write or examine a negative thought or emotion, and then examine the positive aspects of that same topic. The reader is then instructed to contemplate ways in which more of the positive could be achieved while coloring monsters on the opposite page. The book was discovered by the Federal Prison in Florence, Colorado, and it is distributed to the inmates as part of their prison art program. This involvement in the prison led me to teaching a mural painting course in the prison. This mural was painted by 7 inmates and myself in the Canyon City Prison Museum. It is titled Dusk Till Dawn, and it describes the emotions of incarceration from going into the This painting was created inside of the Needle Exchange and deals with my own struggles with addiction. The idea is that through the telling of my own battles and turning them into works of art, I can encourage others to face their own demons in creative and positive ways. The plan for this mural is to have others who are struggling and have them add their stories. We Are In This Together was created by an art collective I'm part of called The Creatures. This is one part of the project sponsored by Cards of Permanente. The project is intended to share the message of how it is okay to talk about mental health issues. The campaign is called Find Your Words and is linked to resources that help people to face and better deal with mental health issues. This part of the project was created by the children from the Boys and Girls Club, the Daisy Girls, Community Kids, and the Creatures. Bringing youth in on the project was the most important part of it, as it shows ways in which art can be used as a healthy form of expression in regards to the things we don't normally talk about. The students of Grizzly Middle School created this mural with the help of PJ Sierra and myself. The mural is 70 feet long and deals with the topic of turning negatives into positives. Seeing others use their voice to share ideas in a healing way is the most satisfying of all the art that I've been a part of. Art has the ability to bring people together through shared interest, community exploration, and discovering new things. This was a group of bicyclists that I gave a tour to the street art and murals. It was a sight to see so many members of the community have experienced the vibrant culture as well as getting exercise and meeting people. Art is a way to connect us. Over the course of my career, I've made so many friends through the common interest of making art. The Creatures are my closest of friends. Though we all come from different backgrounds, heritages, live in different parts of the world, and have different lifestyles, we come together as friends and create together and share in that experience. Art has the power to create joy through visual stimulation. Art creates intrigue by satisfying our urges to learn through creating new things. Art builds community through encouraging us to explore these new things together through collective experiences. And art encourages us to share the hidden parts of ourselves with the world around us in a creative and meaningful way. Art gives to each of us the power to heal. Through expressing and thus releasing our deepest thoughts, emotions, fears, ideas, etc., we're able to begin to release the traumas so many of us bury, causing pain and much suffering. Through creating art, we can heal the parts of ourselves we keep hidden. This form of healing affects the whole community in ways that we can all benefit from. Through normalizing self-expression, we can show how it is okay to express our problems in healthy and productive ways. If we as a community came together and expressed our problems with art, we can then begin to formulate ways to create solutions and eventually heal our community. It is my intention to work with groups of individuals within our city and teach them ways in which they can express themselves and their traumas in a way that is non-invasive, yet expressive enough to share their stories. Through this sharing, I hope to shed light on the deepest problems of our community and begin the healing process for our city at its root.
Good evening. My name is Lindsay Reeves. I am the Launch Together and System of Care Coordinator here in Pueblo. All of the images that you will see are the original works of Mike Archuleta, and I'm very excited to share with you this evening a presentation entitled Community Collaboration Crossroads. Imagine a place where access to care is a basic human right of all and not a privilege of a select few, where a hand up is more than a hand out, a place where the giving and getting of help is applauded and appreciated instead of stigmatized. What would it take for this to be the reality instead of a dream? Committed leaders? Yep. A common vision? Absolutely. Proactive policies? You bet. But most of all, the compassion for one another and the determination to leave this community and its people in a better place than when we found it. A place like Fall Hamilton Elementary in Nashville, Tennessee, where being trauma sensitive means support for students and teachers alike. And Walla Walla, Washington, where a focus on resiliency are just a few examples of what it takes to mobilize a community towards change. Meet Paul and his two kiddos, Zoe, age 7, and Kinsey, age 2. Paul is just 28 and a single father. Zoe is in second grade at a local elementary school, and Kinsey is in an early learning center. While he does his best to care for the girls, he is facing some great challenges. The girl's mother has been in and out of jail in order to get money for her addiction. Kinsey was born addicted to heroin, and Zoe, now 7, is enduring an immense trauma from being separated from her mom. Paul knows his situation isn't uncommon, but hopes for nothing more than to stop the generational spread of adverse childhood experiences, or ACEs, and provide his girls with a life where they can thrive free from trauma. Pueblo is in a particularly captivating space when it comes to our ability to collaborate across agencies and sectors. You could say that Pueblo is at a crossroads, one that could see years of hard work lead to lasting and impactful changes. CTC, SOC, Launch, CYDC, this is what we like to call acronym SOUP. What do all these things have in common? The needs of youth and their families being placed at the forefront of all that we do. Collaboratives such as Communities That Care, System of Care, Launch Together, and One Community are all integral pieces to creating the youth-serving systems that are responsive to needs identified by youth and their families. Piece by piece, Pueblo has been able to take a myriad of funding sources and different programming to create the foundation of systems that are responsive to needs, trauma-informed, and collaborative in nature. Even with all the great work that's going on, we still face some challenges that prevent us from truly breaking down the wall that can change it all. Funding and sustainability, sharing of information across agencies, and true integration and alignment of efforts are just a few examples. The concept of nothing for us without us, this means that families and youth must be an equal partner in both voice and compensation to share their expertise where services are designed. We often see programs that don't meet the actual need because the people that are impacted are not a part of the process. Funding structures for social service work have long been about short-term grant opportunities that are supposed to yield high, large-scale outcomes. We didn't get into this situation overnight, and we aren't going to fix it that quickly either. The changing of cultural norms can take upwards of 20 to 50 years and hundreds of millions of dollars. So changing the way that funding is funneled from federal, state, and private entities to ensure the longevity and sustainability of programs proven to have impact will yield higher returns on those investments. Agencies coming to the same table to talk about issues is collaboration. Agencies doing business a different way is integration. I think common referral program processes where one form can get a family services from a variety of agencies. Pueblo is really good at collaboration, but we struggle when it comes to integration. Along the same lines, the need for innovative strategies is becoming more important. We can't continue doing things the way we've always done them and expect to get a different result. Finally, the most important component of alignment lies within creating a common community vision, one that is complementary to the work currently going on and that honors the intent behind improving the lives of youth in our community. Remember Paul and his girls? Things look a little bit different now for the family. The girl's mom is currently in a treatment program, thriving after being diverted from incarceration. Zoe receives mental health support at her school, and Paul has received services and supports and no longer feels stigmatized. Community change is hard. It's tiresome and it's often burdensome, but the flip side is so much worse. We owe it to ourselves, we owe it to each other, and we owe it to our community to put our differences aside and work for the greater good of all. Together, we are Pueblo.
My name is Javier Quiñones, poet, photographer, and visionary. My presentation is a mix of short stories, poems, and education with a twist. Each piece is framed and can be purchased for $50 a piece out there in the lobby. Now come join me in this odyssey as I take you on the Quiñones vision, a place called Wildlife. Sitting on the branches of a purple-leaved plum tree, behold, the most handsome Bullock Oriole in the land. A vibrant yellow with a black wing and brush strokes of white make this bird's complexion such a beautiful composition. Berries are a major source of the oriole's diet. Truly in reverence in her presence, with smiles and grins, I feel chills from the winds as thoughts of appreciation settle in. She wore the most beautiful white coat with triangular patterns, face white as snow, with a pair of lazy yellow eyes. I guess she feels the effects of Mary. Welcome to Colorado. On a midsummer afternoon, there is a squirrel out and about having a picnic at the park. A supermodel forest dweller strikes a pose, like a model on the runway, sexy, laying on his belly with that frisky look in his eyes, saying, "Aw yeah, it's lunchtime." Her talons grip tight to the top of a dead oak tree 50 feet above. She is small, but she is fierce. She hunts beetles, grasshoppers, and small birds. See this face coming, slick back streaks with gray hair, a young pony boy appeal, and a brown cap. What great big eyes, black as onyx, eyelids like a school bus. Clinging to the flowers of a dillweed is a black swallowtail butterfly. Her body is arched to push color back through her wings and signals into her antennas. Shades of grays and blacks outline the stained glass window in her wings. Body art is an expression by design. Listen. Splish splash, I was taking a bath, says this beautiful dick sizzle. She is taking a morning dip in the magic of a Walt Disney bird bath and butterfly bath. She stands tall and she pushes out her beautiful white and yellow belly with brown wings speckled with a few scribbles of white. Her bold yellow unibrow makes her a standout chick, just another day at the beach. A beautiful tall purple thistle leans over to spill a few seeds. Her bushy carrot top haircut has a few dozen strands of white silky streams. Her seeds are leaving home. To where the wind takes us is a whisper as they travel, like an echo in the air. I don't want to grow up, I'm a Toys R Us kid, says this giraffe as she licks the side of a post with her long black tongue, because apparently wood-looking is a thing. She has super long eyelashes, like an easy breezy beautiful cover girl, a long beige neck, and elongated head with beautiful brown patches all over. This is no stretch of the imagination by any means. Raphael is done fighting crime in the streets of New York. He is due for some vacation time. He has left the sewers for a trip to the Turtle Beach. A hero in a half shell with a painted red bandana and a facial expression that says it all. In the distance he hears, "Cowabunga!" Mikey is doing a cannonball. Feeling rather bashful today is a female duck sitting in the puddles on a lily pad in a pond. I wonder what lucky duck caught her eye today to bring on such flattery. She's got beautiful orange smile with a glimmer in her eye. She knows what she wants, she's gonna get it. What the duck, typo. Cloaked in a luxurious dark brown coat with chocolate and vanilla swirl feathers is a red-tailed hawk. Her sharp talons latch into a branch on a creamy white aspen. She is weathering the cold winter winds, eyeing her prey from a distance. Her glassy yellow eyes with black iris zoom in on the sole of her next meal. The sweet, sweet nectar made with the best sugar and water for a bird like me. I got a beak longer than most. I reach into the depths of any flower to feed my sweet tooth. Ooh, it soothes my soul. I got a white shirt that sometimes gets stained with mouth-watering dripping deliciousness. That metallic dark green on my back is what gets all the ladies. Catch me humming. Painted prints on the wings of this angelic being in resemblance of the autumn leaves of the season that follows. For this is a time of summer blooms, where suns become moons in the light of the night we call day. Like a reverse negative in unexposed film, you can see her aura, a silhouette just like a dream. The love of a rose is like no other. Her beautiful white and shades of pink petals spiral like a galaxy, the Milky Way. Sweet scents are carried by the wind, scents that spin and float through a desired path, a portal into our senses. Morning prayers, though I walk through the valley of the shadows, my stance is ready for battle. Do you know mantis legends? How it all started? It was fighting off this blackbird. Although it was 10th the size of the bird, it was very a valiant insect. A mantis is small but powerful, with its arms that can lift up many times its own weight, a kung fu warrior. I may not be Jiminy Cricket, but let me whisper something in your ear. Today was legs day. Feels like somebody tried to rip my legs out of my sockets. Think I'm just gonna hang here for a while, but I got hops. Once a bird tried to eat me, I jumped 20 times the length of my body to get away. He thought I was a chump, not this grasshopper. You might have seen a house fly, maybe even a super fly, but I bet you ain't never seen a donkey fly. I be that dragonfly. You see me hovering, bobbing and weaving, that's my style. I got double the wings of a butterfly with the same narrow body. I be on the move. Now, I'm not going to do the Woody Woodpecker laugh because I can't, but if anybody in the audience can, please. I like it. Thank you, man. In case you didn't know by the name, I like to peck wood. Your tree got a bug problem? No problem. Let me go handle that for you. Oh, and I'm a redhead, so you know I'm feisty. We house bitches roll deep, invade your area by the flock. A gang of birds just trying to get a hustle for a meal. You see us everywhere. Yeah, we get around. Brothers and sisters and cousins, uncles and aunts, mamas and papas, grandmas and grandpas. When we out, it's a family affair. Thank you.
So this probably won't be nearly as hilarious or poetic as Javier's presentation, but hope you'll still learn a bit and enjoy. So I'm going to talk a little bit about fire ecology and prescribed fires in ponderosa pine forests. They're also called controlled fires. And I'd also like to share a theory about fire ecology with you today. So ecologists and foresters now understand that periodic grass fires are essential for ponderosa pine health, and that the trees have evolved to withstand fire. But how do we know this? We can know this by looking at fire scars on the tree roots. As you can see here, this tree experienced fires about every 10 to 30 years until fire suppression became a very common practice in the Southwest. They do protect themselves with their thick bark and with their very tall branches. They're resilient and they grow in some of the driest areas in the U.S. And I do just want to point out that this picture on the top left was taken by Skylar T. Wright in the back, that beautiful, pleasing fungus beetle with the bark. If these forests are so naturally resilient, why do they need a prescription fire? Today I'm focusing on the pine bark beetle and mistletoe, which are very common illnesses that the trees experience here in the Southwest. Pine bark beetles eat through ponderosas, and they actually lay their eggs inside of the trees as well. The larvae only die in extreme heat or cold, one of those being fire, extreme heat. The trees produce something called pitch, which pushes the beetles out, kind of like a tree sneeze, and they do this only when they have enough. This is dwarf mistletoe. It's a parasitic flower that stunts the growth of the ponderosas and robs them of food and water, making it more difficult for the trees to produce pitch to protect itself from other pathogens. This is the San Juan National Forest. As you all know, this is a very important example of beetle kill, where these trees have become fuel for the 416 fire, which is now raging north of Durango. So ladder fuels, as you can see here, in this beautiful graphic here, shrubs and small trees that carry the fire up to taller trees or the crowns of trees, like ponderosas. Fires are now becoming so intense because of increased fuels, decreased relative humidity, and increased atmospheric temperatures. So prescribed fires do reduce the risk of larger fires in the future because they reduce the amount of ladder fuel inside of the forests. On the left, you can see in picture A is a healthy open ponderosa stand with little to no ladder fuels. And on the right, in picture B, is an unhealthy stand with high numbers of ladder fuels and higher probability for massive running crown fires. So a combination of manual management and dead standing trees, burning of ground and ladder fuels, all of these things are benefits of prescribed fires. But I'm really interested also in how prescribed fires can help with ponderosa pine resilience. For some answers, maybe we could look underground. Research from the University of British Columbia has recently showed us that tree roots and fungal roots act almost like the neurons in a human brain, sending chemicals from different parts of the forest to the other. So what does a brain need to function well? Good, healthy food, nutrition. In this case, nutrients come from broken down, decomposed, dead and or dying plants and animal matter. Yum, the tree's favorite food. And that is made by fungi. Fungi help connect trees' roots through their own root systems. They connect ponderosa pine roots to each other through mycelium, the neurons of the underground brain. This was also taken by Skylar, by the way. If one ponderosa is being attacked, healthy trees will actually send necessary root nutrients through the mycelium to protect that tree. And this connection between the fungal roots and the tree roots is a mycorrhizal relationship. Myco meaning mushroom, rhizo meaning rhizomes. This graphic shows high fungal species evenness in community B down on the bottom, meaning that no one species of fungi outnumbers the others. Species dominance in fungi can lead to lower productivity, as studies show. Studies also show that fire actually increases species evenness among fungus and ponderosa pines, which it could increase the nutrient intake and transfer and overall resiliency of ponderosa pines, helping them fight parasites, invasives, and pathogens. This is the Nature and Wildlife Discovery Center, formerly known as the Mountain Park Environmental Center. And along with the Nature Conservancy, we have been approved by the City of Pueblo for prescribed burns. Although the focus is primarily on reducing the risk of massive fires in the future, I believe there's a great ecological benefit as well. Firefighting communities have shifted their focuses from fighting fire aggressively to safety and understanding fire conditions. There is also a greater focus on fire ecology and looking at long-term benefits as well. With proper training and understanding, I believe prescribed fires could drastically improve the health and safety of our forests. Thank you.
I own Blowback Gallery in the Grove. I moved here 19 months ago from Durango. This is Teenager. Painting by my father, Bud McGee, in 1966 when I was 12. This is the first painting in his Freedom series that will be shown in the gallery opening first Friday of July. Most of the following slides are of my work. There are groups that fit the definition of secret societies. They are the Bilderberg Group, Council on Foreign Relations, and the Trilateral Commission. The CFR was created in 1922 by the wealthiest men in America, and the Trilateral Commission was created by David Rockefeller and Zvi Group Brzezinski. Their members have infiltrated governments, corporations, and NGOs worldwide. Terrorism and central banks are not that much different from each other. Both serve to control people. I am suspicious of all things that the average people believe. H.L. Mencken. General Smedley Butler said, "War is a racket. It is the only one international in scope. It is the only one in which the profits are reckoned in dollars, and the losses in lives." He is the highest ranking, most decorated Marine in history. Holding keyboard keys in space, spelling SOS. If the Earth could communicate with us, what would it say? That's what you get, a screaming eagle up yours if you don't use dollars. Just ask Saddam Hussein, Muammar Gaddafi, or the people who aren't there anymore, who have been bombed and starved by U.S. sanctions. America has been at war 225 out of 242 years. The U.S. has 800 military bases around the world. This doesn't smell like freedom to me. Aldous Huxley said, people will come to love their oppression, to adore the technologies that undo their capacities to think. Our dumb phones are used to track and trace us, and they have been found to listen to us. The NSA can store 12 exabytes of information at its 1 million square foot facility in Utah. Can you say Big Brother? How many humans live in fear because they don't have enough of these? 63% of Americans can come up with $500 for an emergency. 9 people have more combined wealth than the poorest 4 billion humans. Fear is a mind killer. The TARP banks, along with the Federal Reserve, caused a worldwide economic depression, but not one banker went to jail. Every presidential cabinet of recent vintage has had a Goldman Sachs alone. The number of people taking an open-ended prescription for depression is at a historic high. More than 13% of Americans takes them, and they are hard to get off. Why might they be depressed? Uncle Joe Stalin said, "Education is a weapon whose effects depend on who holds it in his hands and at whom it is aimed." American children have been educated under the Prussian education system since early 1900. It takes 1,300 hours of indoctrination to graduate from high school without learning how to think, otherwise known as critical thinking. The Federal Reserve, not federal, no reserves, is not a part of our government. It was created by Morgan Rockefeller and European bankers under very dubious circumstances. It has never had a complete audit. M.A. Rothschild said, "Give me control over a nation's money, and I care not who makes the laws. We are always at war because it causes debt." In 2010, Wachovia Bank was fined $160 million for laundering $368 million for a Mexican drug cartel. Wachovia was absorbed by Wells Fargo, who received $25 billion in TARP money. Bill Clinton did away with the Glass-Steagall Act, a law created during the Depression to present exactly what happened in 2007. There are two wings of an eagle, the left one and the right one. Both are controlled by one brain. It's an analogy describing our political system. You go to the polling place, make your team selection like a Pavlovian trained dog, get a sticker, and go home hoping your team wins. In 4 years, do it again. What is insanity? The War on Terror is a successful military diversion that has been working for 16 years with no end in sight. The military-industrial complex and the bankers can count it as a win, but no one else can. Henry Kissinger said, "Military men are just dumb, stupid animals to be used as pawns in foreign policy." Cognitive dissonance is the inability to hold two or more contradictory beliefs in your mind at the same time. Stop believing things that are not true, do some research, and make up your own mind. Belief in authority is the worst enemy of the truth. Albert Einstein. Six corporations own over 90% of your news and entertainment. AT&T bought the Time Warner Wednesday, and Disney is making a bid for News Corp. The further a society drifts from the truth, the more we'll hate those who speak it. George Orwell. Just kill your TV. View of Blowback Gallery. Oh, never mind. We have power to use your dollars locally, engage with your neighbors, do good work, help people if you can, and consciously try to do more harm. The only politicians we can hope to control are local and in this town. Thank you for listening, looking, and listening. Okay, here. View of Blowback Gallery and sign on roof. I firmly believe one of art's jobs is to get you to think, even about unpleasant things. I understand why you may not want challenging art in your movie.
Approximately 500 children each year in Pueblo County enter the court system through no fault of their own due to allegations of abuse or neglect, including physical abuse, sexual abuse, domestic violence, and severe neglect. These children need a voice and a safe, permanent home. CASA Pueblo provides trained volunteers to represent the best interests of these children as they make their way through the court and foster care systems. Children served by CASA may endure multiple foster home placements, which may also mean they will have to change schools multiple times, even in the same year. They will also likely have multiple caseworkers throughout the length of their case as well, but through it all, they will have just one CASA by their side, speaking up for their best interests and giving them a voice. The children across the service face genuine fears every day. There are so many unknowns in their life, when their next abuse will take place, where their next meal is coming from, sometimes whether they will even have a home at the end of the day. The very least we can do is face our fears and climb down a 9-story building while getting our friends excited to raise money for a cause that gives them a voice. So what is Over the Edge? Over the Edge is the only global industrial rappelling company in the world. They assist nonprofits in hosting safe charity rappelling events. Casa Pueblo is excited to bring this first of its kind event to Pueblo on August 11th. When we decided to take on this unique event, the Thatcher Building was top of my list as the building I wanted to use and to showcase. The Thatcher Building is one of Pueblo's most historic and most beautiful buildings inside and out. Building owner Louis Carleo was excited about the idea and got on board immediately. However, we're still working on getting him to go over the edge. We feel like the 92-foot edge-to-ground rappel distance was perfect. It's just enough to challenge our edgers' fears and sense of adventure. As you can see, we were going over on the parking lot side facing 6th Street. Having this option allowed us to avoid the decorative cornices and the need to build a large scaffolding. The landing area in the parking lot allows for a great spectator point as well. Over the Edge sent out a technician to physically view the building and all safety aspects. During our unique rooftop meeting, we discussed all necessary accommodations needed while overlooking our beautiful city. Upon completion, Over the Edge gave us final approval. Let me tell you, I was biting my nails until that meeting was over. As staff, a few of us have had an unfair advantage in being able to access the rooftop and having the opportunity to measure up exactly what we will be facing the day of the event. I definitely noticed a change in my anxiety level between the first and second time visiting. As you compare the pictures, you can see my counterpart was looking over for the first time. To give you some perspective, we feel the height of the Thatcher Building works in our favor, convincing people to rappel just 9 stories versus 20 or 40 stories is a bit easier. In large cities, Over the Edge hosts these events on skyscrapers. I'm not gonna lie, looking at this picture makes me nauseous. Not sure about you. Every Over the Edge event is set up as an industrial work site that is OSHA compliant and based on IRADA and SPRADA rigging and safety best practices. Yeah, I had no idea what that meant either. Simply, it's a long way of saying safety is their priority. So who is going over the edge? Well, after much convincing, we are led by our leader, our executive director, Zane Grant. He is not a fan of heights, but he loved the idea of the event. He loved that it is unique and exciting, and he knew if he were going to ask others to go over the edge and support his organization, he had to lead the way. In addition to Zane, a handful of staff have chosen to take on the challenge, including myself. Taking on this event, after all, was my idea. So needless to say, there was no doubt I would go over. Every day our staff see firsthand the fears our children face, and they knew this was a great way to shed light on the reality of child abuse in our community and a way to highlight the work CASA does. Over the Edge Pueblo is gaining the attention and support of generous individuals from across our community, even a few from outside our community. Young, old, adventurous, fearful, longtime supporters of CASA as well as first-time supporters. And as if they don't give enough already, we have several CASA volunteers going over the edge, and the list continues to grow every day. Let's talk excuses not to go over the edge. I've heard it several times. I'm too old, are you? Little Joe is 92 years old. He just went over the edge for the second time for his favorite cause in New York. Too young? Well, just last week, 13-year-old Haley signed up. It just makes sense that an event this unique and exciting would garner media coverage, and it has. In fact, we have Tammy Oakland from iHeartRadio, as well as Lauren McDonald from Fox 21 News Mornings, both going over the edge the afternoon of August 10th prior to our VIP launch party. Tammy has had personal experience with CASA and didn't hesitate to get involved. Don't be surprised if you show up and see a couple of our furry friends going over the edge for CASA too. We're expecting to see the Chick-fil-A cow moving down the side of the Thatcher Building. And if all goes well, Wolfie from CSU Pueblo will have a howling good time as he goes over as well. $100,000 is our fundraising goal for this event. CASA Pueblo oversees 3 CASA programs in Southern Colorado. We are serving more children than ever, but we still have to turn away hundreds of children each year due to a lack of resources. With an event this big, this exciting, We knew we had to have a goal to match, and with 92 repelling spots to fill, we think it's possible. What else can you expect the day of the event? Well, food, of course. At CASA, we use any excuse we can to eat, so we've invited a few food trucks to come out on event day and serve up some local favorites. We have Coors Sloppers, Uncle Sam's misguided chow hall, and barbecue. Three Amigos Snowballs, which if you haven't had a snowball, let me tell you, they're so good. And we will, of course, have a DJ rocking all day long. Will you be a superhero when you go over the edge for CASA? For more than 350 children in Southern Colorado, you will be. You are even encouraged to wear your favorite superhero costume with a few precautions considered. So grab your cape, tap into your Spidey, and sign up to go over the edge for our kids today. We know the kids we serve can't personally thank everyone getting involved and making a difference by going over the edge. But CASA Puebla wants to thank everyone who has listened, who has chosen to challenge their fears, who has reached out to friends and family and asked them to donate so that they can go over the edge. And we thank you for letting us share Over the Edge Puebla with you tonight. So on her behalf, thank you.